peaceful eyes. Cellophane flowers of yellow and green towering over our heads.
I'll give Mark a second to start to let him know that we're... Are we good? Okay. I'd like to introduce to you Dr. Stephen Austad, and he is a phenomenal guy because he has done all this great research in aging. You know, when you talk about theories of aging and why, and you talk about things like free radicals and genetics of aging and all of the big questions out there, why we grow old, this is the man who's doing some of the greatest research today in trying to determine what this is all about. And he's going to give you recent advances in the biology of aging, and that's kind of exciting. So welcome Dr. Stephen Austad. Thank you.
Thank you, Michelle. Is this on?
Yes.
My voice usually carries well. Well, thanks for the invitation. If I fall asleep in the middle of it, you'll know why. I just got back from Italy at 10 last night, so I don't really exactly know where my body is at this point. What I'd like to do today is, it's impossible to cover the biology of aging in one lecture, this whole course, at least, on the biology of aging. So what I'd like to do is pare it down to a manageable size. And some of us are out here sort of working away, trying to figure out how to make things age more slowly. You know, ultimately, what we'd like to do is be able to preserve human health span substantially more than it is now. And to do that, we're working with a lot of different animals. And so what I'm going to talk about today, in large part, is some of the most exciting research going on with animals, but why you should be interested in it, because it's going to have relevance to humans in the not too distant future. So I'm going to try to at least partially answer three questions. And I've got this on the handout. What I did on the handout is I tried to scrunch this stuff all to the middle of the page. So if you wanted to jot notes in the margins, you could. The three questions that I'm going to try to answer are, what is aging, or a more technical term for aging is senescence, and how do we measure it? It's not so obvious. If you're clinically oriented, probably pretty obvious to you when you're dealing with an individual patient how aged that person seems to be. But somewhat surprisingly, we don't have any good ways to measure how aged a person is. That is, we don't have any series of markers that can tell us if we have two or three 70-year-olds, which one of them is more aged, or which one is likely to survive or be more functional in 5 years. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that. I'm going to talk a little bit, in as non-technical a way as I can, about the processes that we think are going on that makes things age, because it's not just humans that age, of course. Everything, just about, every animal ages. A mouse ages in 2 or 3 years, and a fruit fly ages in 2 or 3 months, you know, and we age in 80 or 90 years. So what's going on, and what's responsible for that? And then the last thing I'm going to do is sort of go through what some of the most recent animal research tells us. If you follow the news very carefully, you hear almost every week now, oops, they discovered a new gene that makes a fly live twice as long. And you know, what's that all about? Is it anything that you should be interested in? Is it anything that we should be interested in? So let's dig right into it. First of all, what is aging? It's you know, people that work in the field argue about this incessantly, but I think it's pretty simple. So here we have Bill Collins, the world's fastest 50-year-old. But the thing about Bill Collins, even though he's the world's fastest 50-year-old, is that he's slower at the age of 50 than he was at the age of 17 when he won the New York State track title. If you actually go to world records of any athletic endeavor that you want, here I happen to pick the 5-kilometer run, and you measure foot speed, one of the things, now these are world record holders for different age groups. And the key thing about this figure is that these people aren't sick. You know, the people that are getting out there to be 40, 50, 60, 70, they're not sick. They're the world record holders for running 5 kilometers. They're the healthiest people in their age group that you'll ever run into. They probably train as hard, if not harder, than anybody for that distance. However, you see this kind of inevitable decline. It's not because they're sick, it's because they're getting older. That's really, I think, what the essence of aging is. What's causing this? What's going on? The key thing, though, is that a lot of times when we talk about aging, we talk about specific diseases. But the thing to note is that even in the absence of any observable disease, something changes when you hit your 30s and your 40s and your 50s and your 60s and your 70s. And that is really what aging is all about. Now, if you want to try to figure out why you run slower, it's not easy because virtually everything gets worse as we get older. And this is just a little smorgasbord of about 8 or 10 things and how those things, the function of those things, declines as people get older. So I think ultimately what we can do is say aging, we can define it as a gradual and progressive loss of function in adults over time, and it ultimately it leads to decreased health and well-being and an increasing death rate. So the probability that you guys, that anyone is going to die in the next year is a function of age. It goes up, but I'll show you in detail how it goes up with age in a second here. But not only is there an increasing death rate, but there's also an increasing rate in incidence of virtually every disease you could think of. And again, here's a smorgasbord of serious diseases, but also more minor diseases that aren't going to kill you but might seriously compromise the quality of your life, like Alzheimer's, like arthritis, or like blindness. Sure. That's quite all right. So, if those of us who are working away in this field do manage to find a way to slow the aging process, the consequences for humans, assuming that there's a social decision to release whatever we come up with to society at large, is that it will preserve health and vigor and delay the onset and retard the progression of many, many, many diseases all at the same time. For your research buffs, it's much better to delay it, to slow down the rate of aging than to try to cure cancer or to try to cure heart disease or to try to cure arthritis or Alzheimer's disease, because if you can slow aging, you basically are going to slow the onset of all of these things. If you don't, of course, but we succeed by what you think of as traditional medicine, making people live longer and longer and longer, then we're looking at kind of a nightmare, if you think about it. You know, somewhere, depending on the study, between 25 and 50% of people over the age of 85 are demented with Alzheimer's disease. If we succeed, as we will, because life expectancy keeps climbing, and making more and more people live to that age, but we don't do something about aging or dementia, then we have a serious problem. Now, there's all of these different disciplines that are all working on this simultaneously. I don't have any time to go through all of those disciplines, but I wanted you to know that they're out there. There are people, like I say, working away furiously looking for that Nobel Prize, because the first person that comes up with a therapy that slows the aging process in human is going to get a Nobel Prize. It's one of the most fundamental biological questions there is. So first of all, how can you measure aging? Well, if you see the elderly people all the time, you may think this is a ridiculous question. It's not ridiculous if you work with animals, for sure. And it's not ridiculous to your insurance company. They would like to be able to predict very well how you're going to age over the next 20 or 30 years. If you're going to age more slowly, they can reduce your rates. If you're going to really age quickly, they're going to increase your rates. So how can we do that? First of all, I want to give you an indication of how poorly you are at identifying aging just by superficial inspection. So I want you to think, you know, how old is this lady right here? I'm going to now show you how old she is. She's 40 years old. This is what a life out in the sun can do for you. Now, the other thing about aging is that superficial appearances are not all that helpful with people that you're quite familiar with, but if you take somebody that you're not familiar with, like this woman here, who's a Kung Bushman from the Kalahari Desert of Africa. Now, I want you to think about how old she is. And the next picture I'm going to show is her 17 years after this photo is taken. So I want you to try to age her 17 years in your mind and predict how old she is here, and of course then how old she'll be 17 years from now. And there's what the answer is. And my guess is that virtually nobody thought she was as old as she was in the first picture, and that you're absolutely horrified by what's happened to her in 17 years. So the take-home message from this is that superficial appearance is not very helpful when it comes to measuring aging. We have to have better ways to do it. Probably the thing you hear about most is life expectancy. Now we're talking about measuring aging on a kind of a population level. So here's a statistic for you. In 1900, the life expectancy in the U.S. is 49 years, 47 and a half for men, 49 for women. And, of course, it's been climbing like crazy. One of the great prides of traditional medicine is what's happened to life expectancy over the last century. It's unprecedented in human history. Life expectancy has never increased. So that might lead you to think that we're really aging in a different way now than we were then. But we're really not, because it's a crude estimate. Now, if I give you an average of something, which is what life expectancy is, life expectancy is just an average of the age at which everybody dies. Okay, it's that simple. And it's a pretty crude indicator. Usually when we use averages to give us information about something, we kind of think underlying it that there's a nice kind of bell-shaped curve and the average is really showing us the peak of that curve. And sometimes that's true and sometimes it's not. But if you look at what the difference between the year 1900 and the year 2000, the big difference is right here. The big difference is in infant mortality. The number of kids that died before they reached the age of 5 years old. You can see what an enormous reduction there's been in that. And that really is affecting life expectancy. It's why it's such a crude measurement. There is a kind of a bell-shaped curve if you start both of these over about here, of course. And if you do that, you don't see the 30-year difference in life expectancy, but you do see about a 10-year difference in the most common age of death once you get to be, an older person. Most common age of death was 70 to 74 in 1900. It's 80 to 84 now, if you ignore all the young measures. So life expectancy can be a little bit misleading. Another indication that we're not really aging differently, this is a change in our environment, not in anything fundamental about where aging. If you take two people in their early 40s that were born 100 years apart, there's certainly no dramatic difference between their appearance. Nothing to lead you to think that we're aging more slowly now. We're simply living longer because we've created a better health environment. Now, here's the most common way that you're going to see aging measured. It's called a survival curve. And all that is, it's the fraction of people that are still alive at a certain age. Sometimes the numbers run from 1 to 0, and sometimes you create an imaginary group of people, say 100,000 people, and you average, and you basically scale everything to that initial hypothetical group of 100,000 people. And this is what a good aging curve looks like. This is a curve that shows that people are healthy when they're young. They tend to die when they get older. So there's very little change in that for quite some time. And then there's a gradual increase. What we would like to see happen, those of us who work in the field, is we'd like to see that thing ultimately get to be a nice rectangle. See, everybody live to some age, pick the age, and then everybody drops dead when they're perfectly healthy the next day. That would be great. We'd have a life of a length that we chose, and we'd be good and healthy the whole time. If you see a survival curve that looks something like this, this is a situation in where there's a lot of premature deaths. Deaths due to other things than aging. And this is actually one thing we look for, to see if in an animal colony that we're working with, whether we have a disease in the colony. If we have diseases, we tend to get a survival curve that looks more like that and less like the human one. Now, there's another way to measure. This is really my favorite way, and that's simply to look at the probability of dying each year. And this shows really how fast it changes. There's a lot of stuff going on down here. It's hard to see because the numbers are small. What I'm going to do is now I'm going to transform this axis, and I'm just going to make it logarithmic axis, which is really going to kind of blow up what's going on down there. And you'll see quite a change. So here's what it looks like for American men in the year 2000. Now, virtually every organism you look like, if you take care of them well, this is what their mortality curve looks like. It's relatively high around birth. By the way, each of these intervals here represents a tenfold increase in the probability of dying. It then drops to some low level, and then it increases for the rest of your life. The slope of this, the rate at which it increases, you can think of as aging rate itself. Couple of key things to note. First of all, everybody in this room, you're already past your peak. That your peak was right there when you were about 10 years old. That was where you were the healthiest you're ever going to be. We define health by the lowest probability that you're going to die. The other thing that's kind of weird, and this is really a mainly male phenomenon, is this little hump there, which I call testosterone dementia. This doesn't really have to do with aging. It has to do with male behavior in those ages where, you know, from about 15 to about 30, males are completely insane. But it's something that you can see in this kind of curve that you can't see in a survival curve. You'd never detect that in a survival curve. So if we look at the differences between 1900 and 2000, you can see, looking at the bottom here, these top two are 1900, the bottom two are 2000, that the huge difference is really the difference early in life, that when we get later into life, 60 and above, there's been progress since 1900, but the progress hasn't been nearly as rapid, and the progress has not been in changing the slope. We're not aging any more slowly than we were. What we do is we're living in a safer environment, which has pushed these things down. The other thing, of course, is that women, you can see, women die at a lower rate than men at every age, even back to conception. Even in utero, female fetuses die at lower rates than men. We don't understand this at all, by the way, not at all. It's an intriguing question that virtually nobody's working on, but I think they should. And then that, of course, was all measuring aging on a population level. Can we do it on individuals? Well, I said already we can't. Here are two 60-year-olds. You might want to know which one is healthier. It's not obvious from there who's going to live longer. It turns out that this particular man here, Charles Darwin, lived another 13 years. Particular man here, who's the poet, W.H. Auden, lived another 6 years and got a lot worse looking than this in the last 6 years. Okay, so let's go. What causes aging? I'm going to really, you can break it down into the following things. You can see there are internal factors, and there are external factors. And so the external factors would be things like your health habits. You know, do you smoke? Do you exercise? Do you eat right? All that stuff. Internal factors are the things that we're most interested in. What are they? And then the other thing I want to talk about a little is how important it is it for you, if you want to have a long life, to have long life parents. You often hear that that's an important indicator. Is that true? So one internal factor that we can't get away from is metabolism. That is the creation of energy that we get by basically eating food, using oxygen to rip that food to pieces and use the energy that's liberated to live. We talk of respiration in two senses. We talk of respiration as breathing in and out. And that's one kind of respiration shown above. But the other kind of respiration is what really that does. And what that does is, to really simplify it here, we take sugars or other fuels, combine them with oxygen, and out of that, we get energy. The thing about doing that is that it creates some nasty side effects that we can't do. Oxygen is a poison. If I put you in 100% oxygen, you would die within a few days. People can't live in that. It's because oxygen is poison, but it's a poison that we need in order to live. So one of the things that happens And this is the one thing that almost everybody in aging will agree on, is that inside the cell, inside all the cells of your body, there are these things here called mitochondria, and that's where most of this energy liberation takes case. If you look at an individual mitochondrion right here, it really looks like a bag within a bag. This is split open so you can see inside of it. But what's going on in this membrane here is where all the action is. What's happening is that as your food is being torn apart by oxygen, there are a bunch of electrons that escape. Electrons, remember, are these little negatively charged particles. And those little things that escape will glom on to other molecules and call things that we call reactive oxygen species. This is the same thing you may have heard called free radicals, oxygen-free radicals. Reactive oxygen species is just a preferred term for it. But this is one thing that happens when you breathe, when you create energy that you can't get away from. And the thing that makes these important is that they're very high energy. They damage everything that they come in contact with. So if you create an oxygen radical inside your cell, and the next thing that it encounters is your DNA, bang, it damages your DNA. If the next thing it encounters is some of the fats in one of your membranes, bam, it damages that. If it hits a protein, bam, it damages that. And everybody thinks that this is a major contributor to aging. The most general hypothesis about what causes aging is what's known as the oxidative stress hypothesis. And all this is the idea that there's the amount of reactive oxygen species damage that you can't escape, but that there are certain processes that prevent that damage or repair it. And it's kind of the balance between these two things that determines how long we live. So you live 80 or 90 years, and a mouse lives 2 or 3 years. A major contributor to that will be how you handle your reactive oxygen species damage versus how a mouse does it. The other problem with aging that people don't tend to think about is that we have serious problems of scale that you haven't thought about. So here you are, your body contains 100 trillion cells, more or less. That's a big number, right? That's a big number. If you think about it, if something critical goes wrong with any one of those 100 trillion cells, it can kill you. If that cell turns into a cancer cell, that can kill you. Now, one of the consequences of having that many cells is that it's difficult to think about the problems of having that many cells. Well, for one thing, you have a yard of DNA packed inside of every one of those cells. Now, that's a significant packing problem. A friend of mine says, think about packing your DNA into your cells like trying to take 50 miles of fishing line, pack it into a blueberry. You know, it's a huge folding problem. You have a yard, of this double-stranded DNA, and here's the way it's folded. It's folded incredibly intricately just to fit inside the cell. But because you have a yard of this stuff in every one of the 100 trillion cells in your body contains 57 billion miles of DNA. You have enough DNA. If you stretched out the DNA in your body and you laid it all end to end, you have enough DNA inside you to make 30, to go to the sun and back 30 times. That's how much DNA you have. So maintaining and managing that DNA is a serious problem. It's something that we do pretty well, but we could do better. The other thing to note is that these are not a constant cell number. The cells in your body are turning over all the time. So a lot of your cells are dividing right now. And every time it divides those 3 billion letters, that's what that yard of DNA contains, they have to be copied. And they have to be copied very accurately. If they're not copied accurately, then you have a problem. Then you have a mutation. Now, I'm going to try to give you some idea of the scale of what's happening inside your body as you sit here trying not to fall asleep and listen to me. So watch. See, no wonder you want to fall asleep. You just made 250 miles of new DNA in your body. That took a lot of energy to do. The other thing about making all that DNA is that that DNA is under constant attack by these reactive oxygen species. If you think about it, we know that within each cell in your body, there are about 10,000 hits. That is 10,000 times a day that the DNA inside a particular cell is damaged in your body. If you multiply that times the number of cells in your body and how long you live, this is how many oxidative hits your DNA takes per day. Now, that's a number it's easy to write down, but it's not easy to think about. You know, this is, I try to think of ways to represent this number. I finally just gave up. You know, it's something like, you know, the number of known stars in the universe or something enormous like that. But that's the problem. That's the biological problem that you're faced is to try to combat aging. How to maintain those things. So here's the summary and sort of five or six key points. Here's what's going on when you age. You have to deal with the inevitable damaging side effects of necessary processes. So you have to deal with damage caused by reactive oxygen species. There are a couple of other things. And then you have to deal with unavoidable biochemical errors. It was one of the things that makes us animals is that we have biochemical processes going on, and biochemical processes do make errors. They're not 100%. So you make DNA copying errors, the proteins inside your cells get old and weak and feeble and they don't work so well. You have to get rid of them, make new ones. And so the solutions that nature has come up with is either to reduce the damaging products. So you produce fewer reactive oxygen species than a mouse. You know, if I looked at your cells, you would. The other thing would be to enhance repair. Repair the damage better than you did. And this is just a simple diagram, but you have elaborate mechanisms for repairing your DNA. If it's damaged 10,000 times a day in every cell in your body, you have to have good ways to repair it. And we do, and one of the exciting areas of research is trying to understand how this repair works in order that we may someday be able to manipulate it, make it better when we want to, or make it worse. You think, why would you want to make your DNA repair worse? Well, you might want to make your DNA repair worse if you're talking about a cancer cell. If you make the DNA repair worse in a cancer cell, then that cell's more likely to die, which is what you would like it to do. And then we can replace damaged parts. That's another thing. Some animals, by the way, can replace almost everything. You know, starfishes are notorious for this. You know, you rip them to pieces. As long as you have that one of those long arms and a little bit of the disc, can regenerate the whole organism. That's another sort of tactic for understanding this. And your body, by the way, is very good at replacing these parts sometimes. There's this whole process called apoptosis, which really describes a suicide switch that you have in all your cells. And if a cell gets damaged enough, gets damaged too much, it becomes necrotic. If it gets damaged just a little bit, what it does is it commits suicide. And then it can be replaced by a new, presumably undamaged cell. That's the way that we approach the solutions to the problems of aging. The problems is that not all cells are the same. You have the cells in your body. Some of them are almost continually replaced. Did you ever think about why dogs can track humans? What is it about humans that will allow a dog to track you across a field? You as an individual, not just somebody. Dogs are very good at that. The thing is, you're just shedding cells from yourself all the time. They're coming off your skin. That's what dogs are tracking. So some cells are virtually always dividing, always producing new cells. That's good in one sense. It means that those cells are expendable. If one is a damaged cell, you kill it, you replace it. It's not a problem. Here is a problem, though, is that you have to have a well-maintained balance between getting rid of the old cells and producing the new ones. If there's any imbalance, if you're not producing the new ones fast enough, then the organ tends to shrink. If you're producing them too fast, then you tend to get things like tumors, which is not good. So preserving that balance between cell division and sort of programmed cell death is very, very important. And it's something we tend to lose when we get older. The older people are, the more things are wrong with the skin, where you can see them, little lumps and bumps and thin areas. We also have a whole group of cells that do not replace themselves in the normal course of events, but if they have to, they can. Like your liver is a good example of that. The potential problem with that is the same as the potential problem with the first one, is they do it inappropriately. They basically divide, create new cells when they shouldn't, or they don't when they should. So this whole thing of cell dynamics is important to aging. But the key thing is that you have some cells that are virtually never replaced. Your brain cells are one of them. Now, in the news in the last few years, it's been saying, well, it's not true. There are some stem cells in your brain that are replaced, but it's a very, very slow process in just a few places in your brain that this happened. What this means is a cell in your brain or in your heart muscle is damaged. It basically, if you kill it, you're not going to get it back again. And so you don't want to do that unless it's absolutely critical. So the problem is that these cells are prone to accumulate damage, and then they don't work so well, and then you have problems. So just one example of this is if you get an imbalance. Now, I think yesterday you talked about osteoporosis, right? Somebody was in here to do that. You get a little imbalance between the number of new bone cells that are made and the rate at which the old ones are resorbed, then you end up with something like osteoporosis. Okay, so summarizing. As we age, we get a generalized decline in physiological control mechanisms. DNA damage accumulates. Our population dynamics of our cells, the balance between making new ones and losing old ones goes away. We get more damaged proteins in our body. Something I won't have time to go into is we lose a lot of hormonal regulation. Our permanent cells, brain, heart, skeletal muscle cells, they tend to have more damage, and I could go on and on and on. So that's a pretty gloomy picture. So what's the, why do we even think that we can do something about this? Well, I'll get to that in a second, but first I want to talk about how important your genes are. You know, I'm running into people all the time, they say, well, you know, my grandfather just turned 100 last week. And I go, well, that's great. Because only about 1 out of 10,000 people lives to be 100 years old. That's great. So how, what does it mean about how long you're going to live? In other words, how important are genes in the aging? Well, there's two senses in which you can talk about that. You can think about the differences between species. Like, what's the difference between these elderly twins here and this shrew? This shrew lives about a year. These elderly twins are 93 in the picture where they're old. The difference between how long a shrew lives and how long a human lives, probably virtually 100% genetic. They don't have different genes, actually. They have pretty much the same genes. They have different forms of the genes. But within a species, within humans, if you looked at all the age at which people die, and you say how much of that is attributable to particular genes that we have, it's easy to figure that out. You can do it by studying twins is one way. How similar are twins in the age at which they die and how different they are? The thing that makes us think we understand this is that it's pretty similar. So if you take all the variability in the age at which people die and say, what fraction of that can you attribute to the particular genes that people have, or mice, in laboratory mice when you do this, it explains about 20 to 30% of the variation in when they die. If we do it with the baboons over here at the Southwest Foundation for Biomedical Research just across the way, it's about 23%. If we do the same thing for captive humans, which is what I call humans that live in societies like ours, we get about the same thing. It's about a quarter to a fifth. So yeah, it's good to have long-life parents, but the other side of this is if this much is in your genes, the rest of it's in your environment. You can have a huge impact on the way you age, of course, by how you manage your environment, how well you take care of yourself. As people are studying genes more and more and more in aging, we tend to forget this very simple fact. Well, why would you want to study genes and longevity? For one thing, it helps us identify the biochemical processes that are affecting longevity. Easiest way to do this is to change one of the biochemicals. The way you do that is you alter one of the genes, so it's a very useful tool. The other thing is that if we can find key molecules in your cell or in your body that are associated with aging, It gives us a target for pharmaceuticals to address. Say, this particular chemical is very, very important to understanding longevity. Well, what if we can manipulate it with drugs? The key thing to note, and I think this tends to get lost, is that we don't study genes because we're out there trying to alter the human genome. If we come up with a gene that makes us live twice as long, age half as fast, nobody, and we actually have these genes already, and I'll tell you what they are in a second, nobody would suggest, or I take that back, a few people have suggested that we ought to go in the human gene line and change those genes. I don't think we should, and I think virtually no one in the field thinks we should. Thing is, then you're making decisions about other people. You do that, then people who aren't born yet, you're making decisions for them, medical decisions that I don't think you really have a right to make. So that's not what we're after. We're studying genes to understand the process and try to develop drugs. So here's sort of bestiary of animals in which most aging research is going on now. You have fruit flies, which I'll call the fly. They live 2 to 3 months. You have this strange worm, which is about the size of a comma on a page, called C. elegans. I'm going to talk quite a bit about these. Now, what can you learn about aging from something that's the size of a comma on your page? Well, I'll show you in a second. You can learn quite a bit. And then, of course, we use the mouse that lives 2 or 3 years. So I'm going to talk very briefly about these. And your attitude towards all of this might be, oh, what, you know, who cares? You know, elderly people don't care if you extend the life of a fruit fly or not. I'm going to try to explain to you why you should care. So if the thing about it is, if we can do experiments on these guys and we can figure out how to make them age more slowly, that should give us clues as to how to do it in humans. So let me give you 2 minutes of worm biology, which you need to extend. So worms go through these 4 larval stages. Between each one, there's a molt. And then ultimately, they become an adult that lays eggs. They do go through this phase called dowry. Now, why are we studying this worm? The fact is, this worm, this little tiny thing the size of a comma, is better known than any animal on Earth. Let me tell you how well known it is. You've got 10 to the 14th power cells. It's got 959 cells in its body. 302 of those are nerve cells. 131 cells died when this thing was going through this little thing. It's got 96 muscles. Every nerve cell, we know every other nerve or muscle to which it connects. We know so much about this worm, you can't believe. The other thing that we know is that each worm has exactly the same number of cells. They're also transparent, so you can see what's going on inside of them. Now, here's the key thing that we know about worms. They have, if you look at their genome, it's about 100 million nucleotides, DNA letters long. If we change one of those, we alter one, it lives twice as long. Whoa, that's something. We can double the lifespan of a worm that's the size of a comb. The other thing, that's really, however, if we look at the other sex, now these guys come in two sexes, they come in hermaphrodites and males. If we look at the males, changing that same one single nucleotide extends life 6.4 times. Well, what is that gene? Do we have that gene, and what would happen if we would change that gene in humans? This gene is called DAF2 in a mouse. The thing is, if we change that same gene, it actually extends life in both fruit flies and laboratory mice. So, ignore all these letters. The important thing is that we know what this DAF2 gene does. It's what's known in our bodies, it would be a receptor for insulin or for IGF-1, which is a closely related insulin-like growth factor 1. That's what that gene does in that worm. And the only thing to note about that this little pathway is that flies have the same pathway. And that gene is called INR in a fly, and if you alter the gene in a fly, you can make him live about twice as long. And if you alter that same gene in a mouse, you can make that mouse live about 50% longer, not as long. So this is, we know something that alters longevity substantially in worms and flies. Yeah.
Have you tested them for diseases at all? You know, if they live twice as long, but will they still get the same disease they were inherited?
That is a really good, that's a really good point. It's not easy to look at diseases in these guys, but people have done, believe it or not, pathology on these worms. And what they tend to die of is muscle disease, believe it or not. They get sarcopenia. And one of the things that this does is it preserves their muscles very well. It doesn't seem to do much to anything else, as we can tell. It really seems to be specifically a muscle disease. Now, if you look at the mice that they've altered those genes, it seems to make some diseases go away and push back other diseases, because one of the nice things about working with mice is that we can, you know, we could do a necropsy and find out why they died. So this really seems, and the mice have improved memory late in life, they have improved muscle development late in life, they have an improved immune system late in life. So it really does seem to be doing something pretty fundamental. So this is how I can use these little tiny animals to learn something about mammals. Now, is this going to work in humans? You know, we don't know. There's actually a mutation like this that happens in humans. And I just got back from northeastern Italy, right across the border in sort of northwestern Croatia. There's a little island, and on that island there are some people that have mutations in this same gene. The trouble is it's Croatia, and life has been pretty tough for the last 100 years. These people are called Laurent dwarfs, because one of the things, if you partially disable that gene, it makes them small. So the worms are small, the flies are small, the mammals are small. I'm talking small. These people are small. There's some suggestion that they live longer, but it's premature to say that for sure. Well, if we change the genes, there's a couple of things about them. First of all, almost all the changes I'm talking about, we're not taking a gene that nature put there for some reason and making it better. What we're doing is we're partially disabling it. Sometimes we completely disable it. So you might think, well, if nature put that gene there, it's there for a reason. If you partially disable it, you live longer. Are there going to be some other side effects? And the answer is yes. Almost all these things have other side effects, some of which may be serious side effects that people care about. One of them might be, you know, being a person that's that tall. The other thing is that mutation, these genes tend to reduce fertility. Sometimes they make animals completely sterile. So we have to think about that when we're thinking about therapies. We can't ignore it. I think the last thing I'm going to talk about in any depth is going to be caloric restriction. You guys may have heard of this. If you take rats or mice or flies or worms, and instead of feeding them all the food they want to eat, you reduce that to about 60% of what they'd want to eat, they live longer. So here's just one particular experiment where they did this with rats. The closed circles are the ages at which the animals that were eating all they wanted to got cancers, and the open circles are the ages at which the restricted animals got cancer. The thing is, we've known about this since 1935. This was discovered, this phenomenon, in 1935. Some people are actually restricting their own diet to this amount. There's a whole society, a group called the Caloric Restriction Society, that are doing this to themselves. And I've met some of these people, and they're an odd lot, if you think about it. Could you eat 25% less than you really want to? The thing is, if you take some of these dwarf mice that already live longer, and you calorically restrict them, that is, you feed them 60% of what they want, they live even longer than just being dwarfs. This is sort of the best we can do in a mammal right now. We can make a mouse live about 75% longer than it would otherwise by A, mutating one of its genes, and B, feeding it less. It lives 75% longer. It may think it's living hundreds of times longer because life is so miserable. We don't know at this point. There's two unanswered questions about how that works, though. First of all, how does it work? What's the mechanism? What is simply doing something simple like making animals? What does it do inside the cells of those organisms that makes the animal live longer? Like I say, we've known about this since the 1930s. We still don't understand it. The other thing is that we don't know if it's going to work in humans or not. The people that are in the Caloric Restriction Society think it will. They're betting a lot that it will. They're betting, they tell me that they don't miss the food that much, but I don't buy it. I don't buy that at all. I was a wrestler in college, and so I was losing weight a lot. And I know when I was cutting weight, I didn't think about anything else except food. So that might be the key thing that they do. They might spend all their time thinking about what they're not eating, and that anytime they're not thinking about what they're not eating, they're thinking about how long they're going to live. So we don't know if it's going to happen to people. There are two studies going on in monkeys right now that are inconclusive because these monkeys live up to 40 years, and so it's going to take a long time. Some of the things seem to be the same as the rats and the mice, and some of the things seem to be different. Let me just mention one more thing, which is the only thing I'm going to mention about my research. If you take a mutant mouse and you can make it live 20 to 50% longer, that's nice, but what I would like for my research is to really find a super mouse, a mouse that lives 10 times as long, because that's really going to tell me something fundamental. So I've been spending the last few years running around the world collecting mice from odd locations to try to find the super mouse. And I finally found it, but it's called a bat. It's not called a mouse. It's called a bat. This is the little brown bat. It occurs over most of the U.S. Why is it so interesting? First of all, it's very small. They're very small. They weigh on the order of a quarter to a third of what a mouse lives. The other thing is they live over 30 years in the wild. Now, a mouse in a cage, of course, to stay alive, it just has to crawl over to its food dish. Right? That's all it's got to be able to do. It's got to be able to lift its head high enough to drink out of that little zipper tube that it's got. This bat lives over 30 years in the wild. Now think about that. What does that mean about that bat? That means for over 30 years, how do they hunt? They scream and they listen for the echo, right? That's how they catch things. What's one of the first things to go with us as we start to get older? Our hearing, particularly the high frequencies, which is the frequencies that they really need the most. So they've got, now these bats need to catch an insect when they're out there hunting about every 5 seconds to keep from starving to death. So for more than 30 years, they've got to preserve their hearing, their ability to yell, their muscular ability. They fly 50 to 100 miles a night, the agility to catch these prey. Whatever nature has done to produce a bat is something that's so dramatically different than a mouse, it's something that I want to know about. And that's one of the things that I'm working on, but I can't tell you anything about it now because I'm just about out of time. But I will take 10 minutes of questions because they asked me to leave 10 minutes at the end of our question. So
tell us a little bit about what you're working on.
Okay, well, a little. So if a bat lives 30 years, actually we just found a bat that lived over 40 years, 41 years, if you can believe it or not. You think, well, how can you study aging in this thing? I'm not into studying a bat for the next 40 years. The key is that there's got to be something, even in a young bat, that gives you a clue into how it's going to age. And what I'm betting is that there's something in the cells of young bats that's going to give me clues to about how it's aging. So what we're doing is that we have the cells in the lab. We have this little cell zoo in my lab. I have cells from long-live bats, short-live bats, long-live birds, short-live birds, long-live other species, short-lived other species. So we're trying to look for certain commonalities. One of the things that seems to be associated with how long these organisms live is how well their cells resist stress by oxygen. So if I grow the cells from a long-lived animal in 95% oxygen, they survive better than if I grow the cells of a short-lived animal in 95% oxygen. What we're hoping is that if we can understand what causes that difference, we can actually get a clue into why that animal lives longer. And so that's the kind of way that we're approaching this. And so, like I say, I have bats, birds, naked mole rats. Have you guys ever seen a naked mole rat? Possibly the ugliest mammal of all time. They live almost 30 years.
Amazing.
So, yes?
How do you determine how old they are?
So how do we know this thing lives 34 years? It's completely by accident. So somebody in the 1960s for a junior college class, a community college, went out and banded, you know, put leg bands on 4,000 or 5,000 bats. Somebody else working for the state of New York came back 30 plus years later doing some conservation work and looking in caves to see what bats are, and they found some that were banded. And so it's completely by accident. We know these things, that's a minimum. They might live substantially longer than that, for all we know. Same thing happened in Siberia, where they found this 40-year-old bat. It was just one of these accidental things. Somebody marked a bunch of them at one time. Somebody by accident came back a few years later. It's not uncommon, though. A friend of mine, his name died a couple of years ago, named Don Griffith, who discovered echolocation in bats in the 1930s. He had a student out once, and they were checking a bat cave that he'd marked some out, and they were basically going out, and these things were hibernating. They were just plucking them off the ceiling. They were reading the band numbers, and the students recording them in the book. And so Don plucks this one off, and the student, you know, records the number, and he goes, "My goodness, that one's older than I am." You know, that's pretty common in bats. It's absolutely remarkable. Any other questions about any aspect of aging? Anything even that I haven't talked about? Yeah.
I know I hear it on the news nationally about the pill. What is all that about?
Well, that's a theory. The idea is that if you can identify the key molecules, that you could make a pharmaceutical. And so here's an issue that I didn't have time to talk about, but I think is a serious issue for everybody in this room. So let's imagine that I developed this pill, and I won the Nobel Prize now, and this pill's called Longicin, and you take it, and it costs as much as an aspirin, so everybody can have it. If you take it, means you're going to live twice as long and stay healthy twice as long. The issue is now, do we release this? Do we release it to the public, or do we hang on to it? You know, when I poll audiences on that question, I usually get a fairly even split, which is kind of surprising to me. But on the other hand, you know, people are somewhat ambivalent about this whole idea of slowing down the aging process. You know, I mean, people think that if we had that, it would be good. We should release it. Many people think it would be bad. So why do you think it would be bad or good? I mean, I think there are reasonable arguments on several sides of this, but it's an important point, because I think, I don't know if you guys know this, but I have this $500 million bet with this guy about when we're going to have the first 150-year-old human. He's a demographer, so he doesn't know anything about biology, so he's going to lose. But we're going to have this. We're going to have something like this. But it's not going to be as cheap as an aspirin initially. But ultimately, it's going to be here. So there's going to have to be some sort of decision at some point about who gets it. You know, there are vast social consequences, of course. Mm-hmm. Vast social consequences. Well, think about it. Think about it, because this could be something that happens in your lifetime. And I can't think of anything that would change the nature of human society more dramatically than that. I was hired a few years ago to work on a museum exhibition in New York, and one of the things that we were doing is we were planning to put together an architectural prize. We're going to have a competition, have architects design a living space for 7 generations of humans. Can you imagine how complicated that might be, living with 7 generations of your family? For my family, that would be the world's worst nightmare. Maybe your family, that would not be. So, anything else? Okay.